Almost 100 years ago, Oscar Niemeyer was born. He would go on to become the most influential architect of the 20th and 21st centuries. He's 100 in a couple of weeks. Some people get a message from the Queen. We sent Tom Dyke off to meet his hero, who lives in Rio. Lucky old Tom.
Un, dos, tres.
People describe Oscar Niemeyer as a living legend, a genius, a man who's still working furiously today, but whose career began before the Wall Street crash. In Brazil, he's a national hero, right up there with Pelé, the last surviving modernist, and, as his friend Fidel Castro calls him, the only other surviving communist.
Dr. Niemeyer, it's a great honour to meet you, a great pleasure.
Yeah.
Can you tell me, how are you going to celebrate your 100th birthday?
Oh, I think the time isn't important, turning 100. We're here, and then we pass. We each have our little history. We go away and life goes on. Life is just a sigh, that's all.
Can you explain your passion for communism?
I was from a Catholic family, full of prejudices. I saw a lot of injustice in people's lives, so I immediately took the path to the left and joined the Communist Party. It was in the party that I found the best people, more idealistic, more simple, wanting a better life. What is it we want from architecture? We just want a better world.
As an idealistic young man, Niemeyer put himself in the service of the Brazilian government. Like him, socially committed and determined to find its own modern voice. His first major project was the Ministry of Education and Health, now known as the Capanema Palace. Designed in 1936, it was a concrete revolution.
So this is the Capanema Palace. Niemeyer was just 29 when he built this. He was working with the world's greatest architect, Le Corbusier. And you can kind of smell the enthusiasm, the exuberance going on here.
The building is stuffed with the ingredients of European modernism. It's raised on lofty columns known as pilotti, which let in light and air. And it proudly shows off its structure so you can see exactly how it stands up. Inside, the lavish materials are as sharply tailored as a Savile Row suit.
Today, the building is surrounded by cruddy old high-rises that give modernism a bad name. But you've got to remember what Rio was like before this building was built. It was a city of 18th century colonial classicism and florid baroque. And Corbusier and Niemeyer swept that away in one gesture. New York didn't have a building as modern as this, but Brazil did. Brazil was suddenly modern.
Niemeyer worked on the building under the watchful eye of Le Corbusier, but he did manage to sneak in a few tropical touches. Already he was chomping at the bit to escape the rigidity of European modernism.
I just thought there wasn't a single person with any talent over at the Bauhaus. They were obsessed with rules. Picasso wouldn't have followed any rules to do with painting. No one should. Beauty is what's interesting. Difference, that's what I think.
Can you explain why the curve is so important to your work and your way of thinking?
When you have a large space to conquer, the curve is the natural solution. I once wrote a poem about the curve. The curve I find in the mountains of my country, in the sinuousness of its rivers, in the waves of the ocean and on the body of the beloved woman.
This was the first building he really built when he'd had his sort of first flush of success in his early 40s. He had a bit of money, so what did he do? He built himself a fancy pad, and this is definitely fancy.
Your house at the Canoas, it's a fantastic site. It was also, it's your own home. It must have been a very personal and exciting project to work on.
Every landscape is different, therefore the architecture would also be different. The house at Canoas, I didn't touch the land. I put the bedrooms below, making use of the slope, and the living rooms on top. I wanted to integrate the house and garden.
The whole house is built around this giant rock. It crashes from outside to in. I think most modernist architects would probably have leveled it and built the house on top, but here Niemeyer wanted to build the house curving around it. It was central to his philosophy that the curves of architecture and the curves of the landscape should intertwine together.
I think she's beautiful. She's different. You may not like it, but you've never seen anything the same, have you?
Have you?
It was at this house in 1956 that Brazil's President Kubitschek visited Niemeyer to discuss an audacious scheme. His plan? To build a new capital for the country, bizarrely right in its barren centre, hundreds of miles from any other city. Brasilia was born.
Brasilia, the city of the future.
Incredibly, Brasilia was designed and built in just 4 years. It was to be a bold social experiment. All apartment blocks were to be government-owned and available to everyone, which meant top ministers and common labourers would live side by side. Today it's a World Heritage Site, but those socialist ideals have long since been abandoned, and on the outskirts of the city, run-down satellite towns which house the poor have grown like a fungus. Brasilia has become a tragic monumental cliché, utopia gone rotten.
It's difficult. A modern city has to be built on the principle that it will maintain a fixed population. If you let it grow out of control, it's horrible.
There's something very primal about Niemeyer's buildings, very simple, as though he's tapping into some kind of primordial relationship humans have with shapes. The buildings look strangely ancient and yet stunningly futuristic. Across the bay in Niterói, the Museum of Contemporary Art is held by many to be Niemeyer's masterpiece. Not bad, considering he designed it at the ripe old age of 89. The building is so striking that it's perhaps guilty of upstaging the art it was designed to show off. Faced with what must be one of the world's most glorious landscape settings, the Guanabara Bay, I mean, it's incredible, look at it. You know, what does Niemeyer do? He creates a very simple, single rhetorical flourish. Niemeyer himself likens it to a flower. Other people have looked at it and thought, oh, it's a flying saucer. But to me, it's like a cup raised in toast to the glories of nature.
I think it's important that architecture has a sense of invention, something new. When I see a building that has nothing new, it doesn't interest me.
Niemeyer took uptight, right-angled European modernism and loosened it up, tropicalized it. Without him, we wouldn't today have the postmodern curves of Frank Gehry or the melodrama of Zaha Hadid. But like all the great architects, Niemeyer in the end is a one-off. His buildings are instantly recognizable. At times, they're so simple, they're one-liners. But at their best, like the brushstrokes of Matisse, they're perfect, effortless, timeless. Many happy returns, Oscar.